بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا يا كريم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. All praises belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek His assistance and we seek His guidance. And we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the evils of our souls and the adverse consequences of our deeds. Whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees guidance upon, then none can misguide him. And whomsoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees misguidance upon, then none can guide him. And peace and salutations be upon the final messenger, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship besides one Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is his final messenger. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khairan for responding. Let's try that again. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaykum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Barakallahu feekum. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for blessing us to witness this month of Ramadan and the 8th night of this special month. Inshallah, tomorrow we will witness the 8th day. And whilst these days are days of happiness, there's a sense of sadness because tomorrow I depart you all for Melbourne, Australia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that long journey short.
Ameen.
And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep our hearts together.
Ameen.
And grow the love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed our hearts to develop for one another. Indeed, I love you all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us many a time in this dunya to learn together from the inheritance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us in Jannah in the same way that He has gathered us here today. Ameen.
Ameen.
The topic that has been asked of me this evening is a relevant topic. A topic titled Tazkiyatun Nafs, or Purification of the Soul. Now this is a topic which is a large topic. It is a large topic. I am fortunate, it's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen me to be a co-teacher of this subject with one of the senior scholars in Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Sa'ad ibn Nasir al-Shithri, hafidhahullah. We co-teach this subject in Knowledge International University. And as I was explaining to the brothers earlier, this subject is covered over at least 26 sessions. And not just 26 audio sessions, but 26 audio sessions. And then we have, with these audio sessions, written notes, translated notes from the famous book of Ibn al-Qayyim, rahmatullahi alayhi, Madarij al-Salikin. Madarij al-Salikin. This is a famous book by Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahullah. It is a book, and in this book he does the tafsir of one ayah. One ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this book is two volumes long, based on some publications of the book. Some other publications make it four volumes. So it is a large book dealing with just one ayah in the Quran. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. This one ayah in Surah Al-Fatiha. He discusses it in two volumes. In the set that I have, two entire volumes. Right? And these are pages spanning close to 1,000 pages of notes that this great Imam, rahmatullahi alayhi, wrote explaining this ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you alone do we worship and you alone do we seek assistance from. So this short gathering of ours is not enough to do any justice to a topic of this nature. But as you've heard me say before, and it's a famous Arabic saying, مَا لَا يُدْرَكْ كُلُّهُ لَا يُتْرَكْ جُلُّهُ, that which cannot be done in its entirety should not be left out in its entirety. Inshallah, we will become introduced to the topic in the words that I'm about to share with you. And tazkiyatun nafs, as I tell my students, is more a practical topic than a theoretical topic. I share with them theory, but what I set upon them is practical goals that they must strive to achieve, whereby they benchmark themselves against every lesson we take and understand how close or far they are from the ideal. And then they must set an action plan to achieve the ideal. Because what happens with a lot of us, my dear brothers and sisters, and my dear mothers and fathers, and my dear uncles as well, I was told I shouldn't say auntie. What we must understand is that there is a danger, and that danger is hearing a lot of theory and us not translating that theory into practice. When this Sharia talks about the excellence of seeking knowledge, it's not just speaking about learning theory. The knowledge that's being emphasized is knowledge that's put into practice. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Man salaka tariqan yaltamisu fihi ilma, sahala Allahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah," that the one who treads a path seeking Islamic knowledge, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his path to Jannah easier. MashaAllah, Emirates is a busy airline. We have them flying over us every so many seconds. No one here can, from Emirates, can just phone the airline, ask them to divert the... So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the person who treads a path seeking Islamic knowledge, then Allah will ease his way to Jannah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking about knowledge that is put into practice, as our scholars rahimahumullah teach us. And remember, my dear brothers and sisters, that this knowledge is either evidence for us or evidence against us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and protect us. Whatever we learn, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question us about the knowledge which we gained and what we did with that knowledge, because there is no excuse for ignorance. There's no excuse for ignorance. Now, this doesn't mean that we should choose to remain ignorant, because we will be questioned about that as well. Because we have been placed on this earth to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no worship happens except with knowledge. Because we're not supposed to worship Allah how we want to worship Allah. We're supposed to worship Allah how Allah wants to be worshipped. And this is manifest in Surah Al-Duha, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to his beloved Prophet Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى, that we found you not upon complete guidance and we guided you. He was not misguided, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Remember, as we will discuss when we get into the topic insha'Allah, his heart was removed, his chest was split twice when he was growing up, and elements was removed or were removed from his heart. He wasn't upon misguidance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never prostrated to idols. He never drank alcohol. He never supported the burying of little girls alive. He never supported the practice of the Quraysh and their ways with tawaf. He never supported these ways and behaviors and ideologies. But he didn't know how to worship Allah. He didn't know how. And he couldn't worship Allah how he wanted to. He wanted to worship Allah how Allah wants to be worshipped, but he didn't know. So Allah told him, "We found you not upon guidance. We found you searching for the ways to worship Allah. We found you contemplating how to worship Allah, and we guided you. We revealed to you and we taught you how to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us diligent with his worship. Ameen. So there's no room for ignorance. We were sent to this earth to worship Allah how he wants to be worshipped. And Allah revealed books and he sent prophets. So there's no excuse for ignorance. A person who chooses to remain ignorant is liable to being punished. And a person who learns and chooses not to practice is also liable to being punished. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. I say liable to being punished because we know that a person who dies upon Islam and dies upon Iman, then this person's fate is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wills, he will punish him. And if Allah wills, he will forgive him completely on the day of Qiyamah and enter him into Jannah. Such is the amazing nature of Islam, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us when we never even asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He gave us the greatest of gifts, that which guarantees for us Jannah. May we die upon Islam. Ameen. He gave us that when we never asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for it. So imagine what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give us if we ask Him. Imagine what He can give us if we ask Him. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for surely also you and I here discussing a topic which is considered to be a topic from the inheritance left behind by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This get together dedicated towards that cause is a blessing from Allah. We shouldn't feel that we're here because we chose to come or we didn't choose to come. Yes, we have a choice in what we do, but ultimately what we desire and what we choose is under the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tonight in this blessed month of Ramadan wanted to reward us with the reward specific to those who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seeking knowledge. So He inspired us to become part of a sitting dedicated towards seeking knowledge. Wow. By Allah, there's many people who have not been inspired to do this. And as our scholars say, one of the most noblest ways of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through seeking knowledge. Through seeking knowledge that it can be better than voluntary salah and can be better than voluntary fasting, because this teaches you how to worship Allah and it perfects the most beloved acts of worship, which are our compulsory acts of worship. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Ameen. Ibn Abbas radiallahu an famously said, تَذَاكُرُ الْعِلْمِ بَعْضَ اللَّيَالِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ إِحْيَائِهَا. That seeking knowledge and revising my knowledge and learning from the Quran and the Sunnah during some of the nights is more beloved to me than reviving the night in prayer and reviving the night in doing other acts of worship. Teaching us how noble it is to seek this knowledge. May Allah increase our knowledge. We say, Rabbi zidni ilma, for Allah revealed to His Prophet saying, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. We ask our Rabb to increase our knowledge. Amin ya Rabbil Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, tazkiyatun nafs. Tazkiyatun nafs are two Arabic words which have been coupled together. Which have been coupled together in a possessive formation. In English grammar we say this is possessive. In Arabic we say mudaf wa mudafun ilay. Tazkiyatun nafsi. And in English we translate it as the purification of the soul. The purification of the soul. Tazkiyah, this word by itself, in the Arabic language, carries two meanings. The first meaning that it carries is at-tathir. And the second meaning that it carries is an-nama. The first meaning, at-tathir, refers to purifying and cleansing. This is what tazkiyah refers to, purifying and cleansing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in His book, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that indeed the successful person is the person who purifies this nafs. And this is in a surah known as Surah Ash-Shams. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. We find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of the surah taking 13 qasams. If my memory serves me right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes 13 oaths and speaks about this nafs and the success of the one who purifies it. The success of the one who purifies it. And this teaches us how important this topic is and how important it is for you and I to spend our days implementing it. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't take any qasam with regards to anything that is not considered noble. And that is one qasam. But if Allah takes 13 qasams and oaths, then this should highlight for you and me how important this matter is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This process and concept of purifying ourselves. So the first meaning of tazkiyah is purification and cleansing. The second meaning of tazkiyah is an-nama. And that is why we have this name known as zakah. An-nama refers to increasing and the concept of increment. And with zakatul mal, which is the compulsory charity that we give out to the poor and one of the pillars of Islam, it's called zakah because when we give out the zakah, we purify our wealth, number one, and number two, we increase it. Now people might say, but where's the increment? Because when we give it out, there's a decrease. Physically, there's a decrease. But in the spiritual sense, and even in the physical sense, there's an increase, because nothing that we give for the sake of Allah goes without being increased by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us. Allah opens the channels of rizq to become open for us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants us barakah in our wealth. That one dirham, which used to do so much, is doing so much more. Walillahi alhamd. Right? So zakah increases for us, as well as cleanses for us. So this is the meaning of tazkiyah. And when we talk about purification of the soul, yes, we commonly say purification of the soul, but we also mean the actual growing of the soul, the actual betterment of the soul. Right? So it talks about purifying the soul as well as growing it, making it better, making it closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which comes about as a result of cleansing. The second word is an-nafs. And this word alone in the English language, we translate and say refers to the self. Refers to the self. And we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us in components and entities and elements. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us a body, and He made us a mind, and He made us a nafs, and He made us a heart, and He made us a ruh, which is a soul. We are entities. We are entities. And what's amazing when we look at these entities is that the body is the physical apparent entity. But when we look at the mind, it's internal. When we look at the heart, it's internal. When we look at the soul, it's internal. Right? When we look at the self, the nafs, it's also internal, it's metaphysical. You can't feel the nafs, but it's something that is a part and parcel of us. And this should teach us how important your implicit is as opposed to your explicit. How important your internal matters are as opposed to your external matters. Many of us today are so absorbed about the external. How we look, number one, and how people perceive us, number two. And people's perceptions come about as a result of our external. How we dress and the image that we put out. I always tell my students, there's two traits. There's the personality trait and the character trait. The character trait is your true trait. The personality trait is how people perceive you, how you sell yourself, how the brand that you've created for yourself. Right? This world that we live in now in this century is so fixated on the personality trait. We have what we call fans. Fans of the personality. It's a very strong element that's present in society. And if we're not careful, we become products of it. We become judgmental of people based on appearance. And today this is true. We're quick to judge people based on the apparent and never ever take time to give them a chance to explain themselves and try and understand the hidden, the implicit. This is a fact. Today, I mean, even in the marketing sense, what happens? Companies would take the face of a celebrity and put the face of the celebrity on a cereal box. Why? Because that sells the cereal. People are so fixated about personalities, that if we see that this person eats the cereal, you know, he's there with his spoon, right? The milk is dripping and the cereal is on the spoon and he's not eating it, and Allah knows if he even did. But what we know is he received a few millions for just doing that. And people say, MashaAllah, this person eats that cereal, we have to eat the cereal. Personality. Personality. But when we look at our Sharia, brothers and sisters, we see the Sharia emphasize the character trait, not the personality trait. Not the personality trait. If you look in the Quran, and we're discussing bodies, right? When you look in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَهُمْ تُعْجِبُكَ أَجْسَامُهُمْ. That when you see the hypocrites, what amazes you of them is nothing but their bodies, their appearance, the image which they put out. They show you that they're with you. They show you that they believe. They show you, they excite you and they support your views and your policies and so on and so forth. So what amazes you is their appearance. But nothing else about them is worth praising. The Sharia tells us that we should be people of character, not personality. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَى أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. That Allah doesn't look at your appearances, at your personalities, or your bodies. Allah looks at your heart and your deeds. Allah will not judge you to have observed the salah because you looked like you were praying salah. He's going to look at the heart that was present when the salah was being offered. The intention that was present when the salah was being offered. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not judge you to have fasted if you appeared to have fasted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at the heart present when you fasted and the intention present when you fasted. And that is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورُ وَالْعَمَلْ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ حَاجَةً صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى أن يدع طعامه وشرابه. He said صلى الله عليه وسلم that the one who does not leave forged speech, then Allah سبحانه وتعالى is not in need of you leaving your food and drink. He's not in need of you leaving your food and drink. Right? He's not going to judge you to have fasted because you just looked like you have fasted, but you never really fasted. Your speech wasn't a speech of a fasting person. Your actions was not the actions of a fasting person. Your etiquettes was not the etiquettes of a fasting person. Your behavior, your thoughts. May Allah forgive us for our weaknesses. Ameen. Ameen. So, we are made up of elements. Most of these elements are implicit, teaching us the importance of character. And one of these elements are explicit and outer, teaching us that our bodies are important. Allah loves us to dress it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. He wants you to wear the best of clothes and the best of shoes and the best of itar. Dress smart. Show the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you. But understand, O servant of Allah, that Allah made four matters more important. Four matters are part of you that relate to your implicit, teaching you how important the inner is. You can dress smart, but if your inside is ugly, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're not a beautiful person. Right? And we studied Surah Yusuf together in Dubai, walillahi alhamd, over 2 days. And we learned about Yusuf alayhi salam. He had half of all beauty. And he also had internal beauty. He never compromised the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever. And he never spoke an ill word to anybody. Even when he saw his brothers and he knew who they were and they didn't know who he was, he did not take revenge upon them. He did not utter a word against them. In fact, he was absolutely just with them. And when it became known that he is Yusuf and they became sad and regretful immediately, he spoke a beautiful word and said, "Don't be sad. لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. I don't blame you for anything. You have nothing to be, you have nothing to feel blameworthy about. يغفر الله لكم. Allah will forgive you. وهو أرحم الراحمين. سبحان ربي العالى. Half of all beauty on the outside and all of beauty on the inside. May Allah make us people who are beautiful on the outside and the inside. Ameen. So when we see how Allah has taken this qasam, how many times regards to the nafs, and how four elements of us are hidden, and it's so important, right? Even just a point before I move on. We know the famous statement of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he was looking for testimony about somebody, an endorsement, and somebody endorsed him, Umar said, "How do you know? Have you endorsed him based on the apparent? Or have you found a way into his implicit and the hidden? Have you traded with him? Have you traveled with him? Have you lived with him?" Because, you know, even the professionals in the field of leadership and development, they mention these things. And this was taught to us from the best of generations. Right? That the character trait always comes out. No matter how hard you try to hide your bad character and show people what you're not, it will come out. When push comes to shove. When push comes to shove. And when you trade with someone, you're testing them. when you live with them, there's going to be moments that they are going to be uncomfortable and their character is going to become manifest. Right? Right? So the character trait is what shines through all the time. When push comes to shove, who you really are comes up. And thus this highlights the importance of this topic. So in summary, tazkiyah refers to two points. Cleansing and increment. And nafs is one element of the five components that you and I are made of. Now, this nafs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his book teaches us that it exists as three states, or in three states. And this is according to the correct opinion of the scholars, because Allah discusses three nafs in the Quran. And some scholars said there's three types of nafs, and some scholars said there's one type of nafs, but it experiences three states. And this is what seems to be closest to the haqq, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The first nafs, my dear brothers and sisters, is known as an-nafs al-ammara bis-su, the nafs which is heavily inclined towards evil. And this is found in Surah Yusuf, when the minister's wife exclaimed,
وَمَا أُبَرِّئُ نَفْسِي إِنَّ النَّفْسَ لَأَمَّارَةٌ بِالسُّوءِ إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبِّي.
She said, I do not make myself innocent, because they caused Yusuf alayhi salam harm and they locked him up in prison when he was innocent. The scholars have differed of tafsir. Who is saying this? Is this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is this the minister's wife's statement? And what's apparent is this is the minister's wife's statement given the context of the ayat. And we discussed this in Surah Yusuf. So she says, I do not make myself innocent. Inna nafs, indeed this nafs, la'ammaratun bisu. This is the intensified form of the verb. She's not saying this nafs is inclined towards evil. She's saying this nafs is heavily inclined towards evil. Except the nafs that Allah has had mercy upon. Except the nafs which Allah has had mercy upon. So this is one state of the nafs. And our scholars teach us that this nafs is a nafs that loves everything that Allah dislikes and hates everything that Allah loves. And that is why you find yourself in a situation whereby to offer 4 rak'at of salah is so difficult. But to remain lying on the couch watching a football match for 90 minutes is easy. The nafs needs work. This happens, right? I mean, you think to get up for 5 minutes to worship Allah is like subhanallah, right? It's like we have to lift a mountain. But to remain lying and delaying the salah is easy. Why? Because this is a nafs that is inclined towards evil. This is a nafs that is not beloved to Allah. This is a nafs that wants to follow hawa. And hawa refers to something that descends. Allah says, "Wan najm idha hawa." Allah takes a qasam by the star when it drops at excessive speeds. Hawa is something that falls, that is lowly. Right? So your desires are called hawa because they're lowly. There's no greatness in it. There's no grandeur in it. It has nothing worth praise. Nothing which Allah dislikes is worth praising, even though shaitan beautifies it. And nothing which this hawa makes beautiful, which Allah dislikes, is worth praising. Nothing. It has nothing worth praising. It's lowly. It's debased. It's debased. So this nafs which is inclined towards evil is a nafs that loves this hawa, matters which are debased. And this is where your test and my test comes in. Because this nafs is part of us and it is that tool which tests us, which we need to exercise patience with regards to. And we have to train it. And we need to, you know, tenure labor with it. We need to be laborious with this nafs. It requires effort from us. And when you and I are laborious with the nafs and tell it no when it wants music and it wants haram and it wants all that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes and delaying the prayer, when we say no to it and fight it and push it towards ibadah and that which Allah loves even though it hates it, It becomes a nafs that Allah praises. And this is the second state of the nafs. It becomes a nafs al-lawwamah, the self-reproaching nafs. Allah loves this nafs and loves this person because he's fighting this nafs for the sake of Allah. He's not doing it for anything else. Why? I mean, the nafs is inclined to that which his hawa and desires are inclined to. So the fact that he's fighting what he by nature loves shows that he's doing it for who? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it becomes beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا أُقْسِمُ بِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah takes a qasam by the day of judgment. This is noble. We said earlier, Allah doesn't take a qasam by anything which is not considered great and magnanimous and mighty. Allah takes a qasam by the day of Qiyamah. And then Allah says, وَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِالنَّفْسِ اللَّوَّامَةِ. Allah takes a qasam by the self-reproaching nafs. Allah takes a qasam by it because Allah considers it great and considers it beloved. So he takes a qasam by it. That when you fight for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to be upon what Allah loves this, my dear brothers and sisters. Right? And this happens when you purify yourself. This is a state of the nafs which is beloved. And Allah has another state for this nafs. When this nafs succeeds, when this nafs succeeds in being laborious with itself until a point when it becomes naturally inclined towards that which Allah loves. This is another state where the nafs is naturally inclined to that which Allah loves. When the adhan goes, this nafs immediately gets up and performs the best wudu and intends the masjid. Nobody has to tell it anything. It doesn't have to fight itself. It's an automated effort. It is naturally inclined towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the month of Ramadan comes, it naturally anticipates it and loves it because it loves worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in different ways, and the month of Ramadan brings about ways in which you and I can worship Allah, and those ways do not present themselves to us outside of Ramadan. Salatul Taraweeh, for example. Salatul Taraweeh. This is an ibadah specific to Ramadan. We are able to worship Allah, a worship that we cannot do during the rest of the year. So the nafs is excited. The nafs is excited. Why? I'm able to worship Allah in a way which is special. I cannot do this outside of Ramadan. And this nafs is inclined to Allah, so it's excited about Ramadan. We always say, brothers, Ramadan is coming. Ramadan Kareem. Ramadan Kareem. Why is Ramadan Kareem? Is it because we can eat at 4 a.m. in the morning and 3:30? Is that why it's Kareem? Yes, that is why it's Kareem also, because suhoor is another ibadah. Suhoor is another ibadah. We worship Allah by practicing suhoor in Ramadan. This is specific. We can practice suhoor any time of the year. But the suhoor of Ramadan is another type of suhoor. Its blessings are specific. So we worship Allah in another way. This is a nafs that Allah has titled An-Nafs Al-Mutma'innah. An-Nafs Al-Mutma'innah. And we find Allah talking about this nafs in the last juz, the 30th juz in Allah's book. And Allah tells us that this is a nafs that Allah calls out to at the time of death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls unto this nafs. Allah says, Ya ayyatuha an-nafsul mutma'innah. Allah calls out to this nafs at the time of death and says, O content nafs, O nafs which loves Allah and loves all that is beloved to Allah, irji'i ila rabbik radiyatan mardiyah. Return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst you are pleased with Allah and Allah is pleased with you. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. What an amazing death a person experiences when they get this, they receive this call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the most scariest moment of your life and my life. Wallahi, you know, it's no secret. We are scared of death. We are scared of death. Anyone who tells you otherwise is not being truthful, and Allah knows best. It is the most scariest moment in our lives, brothers and sisters. But to receive that call at the most scariest moment in our lives, knowing that after this moment, the end is perpetual bliss, that makes that moment the most beloved moment to us. Yes, we're leaving our families, but we still love to go to Allah, because Allah is more beloved to us. Wallahi, you and I live in this world. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, we don't know today. Today we did something good. Allah is happy with us. We don't know about tomorrow. The day you die, you know it's khalas. It's come to an end. This challenge of fighting shaitan and fighting our nafs and fighting the hawa and the desires. And you know, I tell people many a time, we say life is hard. We say, why? They say, because prices are going up. You know, recessions happen. Cost of living is high. Right? But who says today life is hard? Because wallahi, remaining sincere is hard. Gaining taqwa is hard. Pleasing Allah is hard. Wallahi, there's so much vice. There's so much vice around us. Today Allah could be happy with us. Tomorrow we don't know what will be our plight. We don't know. When do we say life is hard because of this, brothers and sisters? So tazkiyatun nafs, or what we have said in explaining tazkiyatun nafs, also aids us in understanding how important tazkiyatun nafs is in our life. Since we're discussing the importance of tazkiyatun nafs, let's continue before going into the ruling of studying a topic titled tazkiyatun nafs. From the matters that make tazkiyatun nafs an important subject, brothers and sisters, is that purifying the self is from the ways to Jannah. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the second surah of the last juz, says, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. That the one who fears his standing in front of his Rabb on the day of Qiyamah, مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ, he feared his standing in front of Allah on the day of Qiyamah. وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى, and he protected his nafs from following its desires and his desires, and protected himself from haram. He persevered with his nafs. He was laborious with it. Allah says, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى, the net result of this is that Jannah will be his abode. Jannah will be his abode. And that is why we must understand the Quran, brothers and sisters. We must at least have a good English copy and read the Quran every day. This helps our purification. This helps our process. When we read these ayat and see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has packaged for certain acts, you and I know in the dunya we always say that, you know what? This job is a good job. Why? The package is amazing. This degree is an amazing degree. Why? The package is amazing. If you become a doctor, you know what the benefits are? If you become a pilot, do you know what the benefits are? We say, brother, if you are laborious with your nafs, do you know what the benefits are? Understand how noble it is and how amazing it is to be laborious with your nafs. For the benefits is none other than Jannah. Nothing else but Jannah. The prize of prizes. The best end of any end you can imagine. May Allah make us from the people of Jannah. Ameen. Ameen. Our scholars, rahmatullahi alayhim, in teaching us this topic, discussed the ruling with regards to learning tazkiyatun nafs, learning what purifies the soul. The scholars have two views regarding this. Imam al-Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, his view is that it's compulsory for every Muslim to study this topic. whether he's a good Muslim or a bad Muslim. It's compulsory, and if he doesn't, he's sinful. But the majority of scholars say that it's not compulsory for you to study tazkiyatun nafs unless you have understood that you've become a bad person. You see that you have bad qualities. You see that your heart has evil and sicknesses. You see that your character has defect. You see that your speech has issues. When you see this, it becomes compulsory for you to cure it. And curing it happens through studying, purification of the soul, and putting its lessons into practice. This is the view of the majority. So the first view, it's compulsory in any circumstance. The second view, which is the view of the majority, it's compulsory only when you have a sickness that requires a cure. Why did Imam Al-Ghazali say it's compulsory? Imam Al-Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi, says it's compulsory because he has taken the belief that you and I by default have evil. You and I by default have evil tendencies. And he cites as evidence the fact that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had his chest cut open twice and with elements removed from it. And he says these elements were the elements of evil, they were removed from him sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Or these elements of weaknesses, let's not say evil, let's say weaknesses. These elements of weaknesses were removed from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which you and I still have. So if that happened to him and he was the best of creation, then it has to be something compulsory for everyone who is lesser than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, meaning you and I. This is what he says. The majority of the scholars say no. They say no. They say that you and I by default are innocent and free from evil. So it's not compulsory to purify that already clean. It becomes compulsory when evil enters. When evil enters. You see, subhanAllah, how deep the fuqaha were. Right? Look how they were building their arguments. The argument of compulsory from the outset versus compulsory only when you know you have a sickness was based upon another pretense. And that pretense was, what is the essence of you and I, or the outset of you and I? Are we evil people by nature, or are we innocent, clean people by nature? Or let me rephrase that. Are we people capable of having evil tendencies by nature? Or are we people who are innocent by nature and our environments pollute the self, and thus we need the process of purification to assist us in our navigation of our environments? See how they built it? Amazing. Rahmatullahi alayhi. May Allah gather us with them in Jannah. Ameen. The majority of scholars, to substantiate their view, they say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فِطْرَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي فَطَرَ النَّاسَ عَلَيْهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that we were created upon a natural disposition. And this natural disposition was a disposition of tawheed and belief in the lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the nature of you and I is pure. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّ مَوْلُودٍ يُولَدْ عَلَى فِطْرَتِهِ, that every newborn child is born upon his fitrah, upon this natural disposition which we have established is pure. Which we have established is pure. And then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that our environments pollute us. That it's our parents who make us Christian and Jewish and fire worshippers and so on and so forth. Right? So from the outset we're pure. And then we are polluted. So what do they say to Imam Al-Ghazali's argument that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had his chest open twice, and what was removed from him was that which entails us having issues from the outset? What did they say to him? They say that what was taken out from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the elements. They say what was taken out from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that which would make him prone to being affected. Is that clear? What was taken out from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was that which would make him prone to being affected. And you and I have that in us, that which makes us prone to being affected. Which means we're innocent from the outset. But we have elements in us which make us prone to being affected by evil. And thus we become encompassed by evil and need purification of the soul as a result. Does that make sense? Right? It doesn't make sense because you were drinking water when I was speaking. Let me say that again. Imam Al-Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi says, from the outset you and I have issues. That's why it's compulsory for you and I to study Tazkiyatun Nafs. Is that clear? Why does he say this? He says, proof of you and I having issues from the outset is the fact that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a human being like you and I, and Allah decreed that his chest be opened on more than one occasion, and certain elements were removed. These elements were elements to protect him. You and I, our chests were not opened. We have those elements, right? We have those elements. So Imam Al-Ghazali says, the evil of the self was removed from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for those who didn't have their chest removed, the evil of the self exists. So from the outset, you and I have evil elements, thus we need to study purification of the soul. Is that clear? The majority of the scholars disagree with him, that you and I have evil elements by default. They say that Allah created us upon a pure fitrah. So it's not compulsory to study tazkiyatun nafs. It's only compulsory to study tazkiyatun nafs when we become polluted. But from the outset, we're pure. Right, now we have a problem. What is the problem? The evidence of Imam Al-Ghazali, rahmatullahi alayhi. What do we say about his statement about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam having had his chest open and the elements removed? We can't just leave the discussion here. We have to respond to him. They respond by saying that he didn't have evil elements that were removed. Nobody has evil elements in them from the outset, including Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So what was removed from him? They said what was removed from him were elements that were prone to being polluted by shaitan and evil environments. Those elements were removed. Thus his evil environment did not affect him. Shaitan could not affect him. What shaitan uses to get through to us was removed from him. Is that clear? The weakness. So the weakness was removed. We're not saying, meaning, you could call it a weakness. You could call it a weakness. But we say the element that makes us vulnerable was removed from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not evil. We don't say evil was removed from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We say that which makes us vulnerable towards evil was removed from him. Which means from the outset, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was pure. And you and I are pure. There's no evil in us. But you and I have elements that make us prone. So we have to be wary of it. When we become polluted, studying purification of the soul becomes mandated. This is the view of the majority. Ala kulli hal, this is an academic discussion for you all, because we're doing a run through the topic called Tazkiyatun Nafs. So alhamdulillah, we discussed the term Tazkiyah. We discussed its meanings. How many meanings does Tazkiyah have? And we discussed Nafs, and we said this. How many types of Nafs? Three. Which is the most beloved Nafs to Allah? Mutmainna. And which is a praiseworthy Nafs? Al-Lawwama. Excellent, mashaAllah. What is the ruling regarding studying this particular topic, Tazkiyatun Nafs? Imam Al-Ghazali says it's compulsory. And a few others like him. And the majority of scholars said it's not compulsory. Only when you become affected. When you start becoming a jealous person. When you start becoming an envious person. When you start backbiting, when you start lying, you've adopted these traits. Evil traits have your vulnerable nature has been taken advantage of by shaitan, and now you're becoming a bad person. Now you need to start studying. It becomes compulsory upon you. It doesn't mean you're not supposed to study it before, but we're saying, when are you sinful? If I tell you, brother, it's compulsory for you to study Tazkiyatun Nafs and you haven't, what does that mean? It means you're sinful if you don't. But if I tell you it's not compulsory, only when you become a bad person, when you start manifesting signs of evil, that means you're not sinful until you start manifesting signs of evil. Does that make sense? These are Sharia rulings. This is why we say hukm shar'i. When we say what's the ruling, when we say it's compulsory, it means if you don't do it, you're sinful. Right? And no doubt all the scholars agree that it's better for you to learn about it before you become affected, because prevention is better than cure. There's a principle in fiqh, in Islamic jurisprudence, which says الرَّفَعْ أَوْلَى مِنَ الدَّفَعْ. Prevention is better than cure. Prevention is better than cure. You should learn what is evil so you can be on guard. You need to learn what are the qualities of shaitan so you can be on guard. You need to learn what are the good qualities of the heart that fend off the evil of shaitan so you can be on guard. You need to learn the sicknesses of the heart so you can be on guard. Do you know the heart gets spiritually sick? Do you know the types of sicknesses that affect the heart? Right? You need to be on guard. And inshallah we'll touch on this, on these matters as we go along. So alhamdulillah, we also discussed to this point the importance of learning tazkiyatun nafs. And we said from the important matters is that Allah took oaths before saying قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. The successful one is the one who purifies this nafs. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. And the wretched one is the one who leaves it to rot. May Allah protect us. وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. The one who leaves it to rot is a wretched person. And we said from the important, or from the elements that teach us how important it is to study tazkiyatun nafs, is the fact that the prize for it is Jannah. Because Allah said, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَى. Okay, brothers and sisters, what are the categories of tazkiyatun nafs? There's two categories of tazkiyatun nafs. The first category refers to at-takhliyah, and the second category refers to at-tahliyah. At-takhliyah refers to cleaning the impurity, and at-tahliyah refers to polishing the surface. You know, when we clean, do you come with polish when someone's messed, or do you come with the cleaning agent first? You come with the cleaning agent first, right? You don't, there's mess on the floor, you don't come with perfume. Doesn't make sense, right? We come, the brothers don't know, they don't clean enough, isn't it? Huh? We must clean. All of us must clean. It's not only the sisters' prerogative. May Allah bless them. We clean first, then we perfume and polish. And this is why many a time you and I ask, you know, in Ramadan, what should we do? Should we do more tasbih and tahmeed and takbir or istighfar? What should we do more? Should we do istighfar more or praise Allah more? Should we seek forgiveness more or praise Allah more? Should we praise Allah first, then seek forgiveness? Should we seek forgiveness, then praise Allah? What do we say based on this? We say, seek istighfar first, because istighfar is cleaning the impurity. And then your dhikr is polishing and scenting the surface. So the scholars say, at-takhliyah qabla at-tahliyah. That cleaning the impurity comes before polishing and scenting the surface. Right? And these are two categories of purification of the soul. Purification of the soul entails cleaning and entails polishing and scenting. At-takhliyah refers to cleaning. At-tahliyah refers to polishing and scenting. Does that make sense? I think we have a good example. Huh? Cleaning. You know, when you're dishes, you want to wash your dishes after eating. What do you do first? You remove the... Not so. You don't just start putting it in the cupboard and say, khalas, it's clean. You clean it first, right? And then you rinse it, right? And then you wipe it nice and dry, and then you pack it. Now it's clean. It's shiny, right? So, tazkiyatun nafs entails this. We say, astaghfirullah, to clean the surface, the sin. What happens to the heart when you expose it to desire? The heart absorbs the desire like a sponge until it becomes a black dot on the heart. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that these sins entail black dots forming over the light of iman. And what happens as these dots increase, the light of iman becomes lesser and lesser and lesser and lesser until it can no more be seen. And this is how we understand a person when he goes into sin. A good person doesn't sin immediately. What happens? First they're in the front line of the masjid. Then, first they must start their salah with the imam. The first takbir with the imam. But what happens later on? They don't just leave salah altogether. You see they're coming late. They're in the front line, but they're late. Then they're in the second row. Then they're in the third row. Then you don't mind, you see them, they've missed the whole rak'ah. Right? What's happening? The iman, light that was shining bright, is slowly being covered. And as it gets, meaning as the intense ability of one's iman to shine becomes weaker, you find the ibadah becoming weaker, shay'an fa shay, slowly but surely, until he's reading salah at home, until he's reading now salah at the end of salah time, until now he's doing qadha of salah. What's happened? The heart has become filled, rana ala qulubihim. He has dots that have hidden the light of iman. So now you have to you take a shovel and a spade, and you have to dig. You have to dig this dirt out. How? Through istighfar. How? Through tawbah. How? Through istighfar. How? Through tawbah. Astaghfirullah. Astaghfirullah. Turning to Allah. Asking Allah to forgive you for your major sins. Because when istighfar is for the minor sins and the major sins. But tawbah is specific for the major sins. For Allah to forgive you for your major sins, you have to practice tawbah. And tawbah comes with its own conditions, its own pillars, its own elements. And that's beyond the scope of our sitting today. Inshallah, in another sitting, we'll discuss a detailed study of at-tawbah. Of at-tawbah. So we clean the surface and shovel the surface with istighfar. Now when the light of iman begins to shine, we strengthen that light through our tahmeed, alhamdulillah. At-tasbih, subhanallah. At-takbir, Allahu Akbar. Al-hawqala. Hawqala, what's hawqala? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Right? This is hawqala. Did you know that? This is what it's called. Hawqala. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Right? We start polishing, we start strengthening this light of iman. And as this light of iman becomes stronger and stronger, you and I become more distant from sin. This is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, brothers and sisters, with regards to the heart. The closer the heart is to Allah, the more distant it is from sin and this dunya. The closer the heart is to this dunya, the more distant it is from the akhirah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the strength of iman. This is how it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Hadid, He says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلُ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, has the time not come for the people of iman, for you and myself, for our hearts to experience khashya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala based on this Qur'an and that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in truth? Allah says, وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ. And ensure that they do not become like the people before the people of the book, the Christians and the Jews. فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدِ. They became a victim of this dunya. They became attached to this dunya. They became a victim of time. Their money was in their hearts and not in their hands. Their houses were in their hearts and not in their hands. Their children was in their hearts and not in their hands. Where they put their children before Allah. They put their children before the message that the Prophet came with. They became victims of life in this world. فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. This is the point. This is the point, brothers and sisters. As a result of becoming attached to this dunya, their hearts became hardened. Their hearts became hardened. And they became distant from Allah. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Their hearts became hardened and they became sinners. They became sinners. When do you become a sinner? When this light of iman disappears. When do you become detached from your akhirah? When the light of your iman disappears. This, contemplate the Qur'an, brothers and sisters. That's why one of the ways to do tazkiyah is through tadabbur al-Qur'an, to contemplate over the Qur'an. This is one of the ways of tazkiyah. Their hearts became hardened. The light of iman vanquished. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Most of them became sinners. But Allah gives us hope. Allah tells the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if you have a hard heart, don't lose hope. اِعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. That know that Allah can give life to dead land. And Allah can give life to your dead heart. Spiritually dead heart. Right? Allah is giving us hope that whatever your situation is, my dear brother and my dear sister, no matter how much you are drowning in sin, no matter how far you feel from the mercy of Allah, no matter how close you feel you're going to Jahannam, you're destined for Jahannam, you have no hope. No, my dear brother and sister, Allah said, اِعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يُحْيِي الْأَرْضَ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. That understand and know that Allah can give life to dead land. And if Allah can give life to dead land, He can give life to your dead heart. Never lose hope. Purify it. Take the means of purification and put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And beware of a dead heart, my dear brothers and sisters. Because nothing is worse than a dead heart. When you don't purify your nafs, your heart becomes hard. And there's nothing worse than a dead heart. Even there's nothing worse than a hard heart. It's so dead, there's nothing that can be more dead than it. Even a hard rock is more alive than a hard heart. This is true. Allah in Surah Al-Baqarah says, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ telling Banu Israel, then your hearts became hardened. فَهِيَ كَالْحِجَارَةِ So it was like a rock, hard like a rock. Allah says, oh, أَشَدُّ قَسْوَةً It was harder than a rock. Why? Allah says, when we look at the rocks, وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْحِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَتَفَجَّرُ مِنْهُ الْأَنْهَارِ We have rocks that split and allow rivers to flow through it. That's beneficial. So there's benefit. A rock has benefit. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْهِجَارَةِ لَمَا يَشَّقَّقُ فَيَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ الْمَاءِ There's some rocks that crumble and water comes out of them. Subhanallah. وَإِنَّ مِنْهَا لَمَا يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ And there's some rocks that you see them falling down out of the khashya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar. وَمَا اللَّهُ بِغَافِلٍ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ And Allah is not unaware of what you do. When you see these rocks falling from mountains, don't just take it for granted. Allah is telling you they're falling out of khashya. You know what khashya is? What is khashya?
Fear.
No. That's khawf. That is khawf. Khashya is a higher level than khawf. Khashya is fear of Allah with knowledge about the one who you fear. It's not raw fear, it's fear with ilm, with knowledge. That's why Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاء That the true people of khashya are the ulama. They have knowledge. They transcend the level of khawf, which is raw fear. They fear whilst knowing who Allah is, and knowing His command, and knowing the evidence for this action, and knowing the reward for the one who does it, and knowing the punishment for the one who leaves it. This is khashya. It's fear with knowledge. Fear plus knowledge equals khashya. Allah says these rocks have khashya, my dear brothers and sisters. They fall out of the... Allah could have said they fall out of the fear of Allah, khawf. Allah said they fall out of the... with khashya. يَهْبِطُ مِنْ خَشْيَةِ اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْأَعْلَى May Allah make us beneficial people. Ameen. How do we purify ourselves, brothers and sisters? Purification, brothers and sisters, happens through what we said, تَخْلِيَةَ and تَحْلِيَةَ Cleaning the surface and then polishing it. But how do we clean and polish? We clean ourselves, brothers and sisters, by ridding ourselves from the qualities of shaitan. The worst quality of shaitan is arrogance, self-amazement, ujub, as we say in the Arabic language. This is very dangerous, brothers and sisters. And you and I have it to some level. May Allah forgive us. When Allah created Adam alayhi salam and asked the creation of the skies to bow down to Adam, shaitan did not. إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرَ Allah says he refused and manifested arrogance. This is the command of Allah. Iblis believed. Did he not believe? He's seen the unseen. He has seen the unseen. But his nature got the better of him. He says, no, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ I am better than him. Arrogance. I am better than him. Now, when I say you and I manifest arrogance in this, in some way or form, we might not have this, I am better than so and so, inshallah, inshallah. This is me having good thoughts in my brothers and sisters. We never have this, I am better than him. We never have this. You know, sometimes cultural issues give us this, these statements. These statements. Once there was a boy who wanted to marry a girl, and she was from a different Indian background. But good person, good family, family of Iman, good character. And when the question was coined, why not? Very arrogantly it was said, because these people come from a tribe, they considered the sweepers of society. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. This is, how different is this from the statement of Shaytan, Ana khayrun min? When you say somebody is considered to be from the sweepers of society, you're saying you're better than them? This is dangerous, my dear brothers and sisters. This is a dangerous trait of the heart. And this is from the traits that Shaytan loves, and what destined him to the hellfire. This ujub and self-amazement. Islam came to teach us a different quality of the heart, which purifies the nafs as well. And that is the quality of taqwa. Taqwa is from the means of purifying this nafs. Chasing taqwa is a means of purifying this nafs. And this is the month that we are in. Right? Because Allah said, Inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha, waja'alnakum shu'uba wa qabail lita'arafu. We created you from one male and one female, and then we dispersed you into different tribes and nations. Why? Why? So that we can recognize each other. Imagine if, you know, everyone looked the same. Same color, same voice, same language, same eye color, same facial type. When I look at you, I'm looking at myself. How boring is that? Say, wait, let me see how I look. Just stand in front of me, man. I look in front of you, I'm seeing myself. How boring would life be? Right? Imagine, we all ate the same food and the same and the same. You want to go to the restaurant, only one restaurant exists. Same food everywhere. No choice. Allah says, لِتَعَارَفُوا. We did this so you could recognize each other. But Allah says, إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. This concept of I am better than him, only Allah judges. And Allah judges based on who has more taqwa. Who has more taqwa. And Allah didn't put taqwa meters on our foreheads. Now I look at Abu Hisham. Let's see your taqwa meter. Oh yeah, you half tank. I'm three quarter tank. I'm better than you. No. Allah didn't give us taqwa meters. The taqwa levels will be revealed on the day of Qiyamah, when nobody's worrying about being better than the next person. Everybody's worrying about themselves and Jahannam that is blazing. May Allah protect us from the hellfire. Right? So we rid ourselves of the qualities of Shaytan. Arrogance. Now, as I said, some of us have it in some way or form. Maybe we don't have this, inshallah. And if we do, we must fix it immediately. But there's another type of arrogance which we have. And that is the arrogance of not attributing your success to Allah. This is from the evils of the heart, which extinguishes the light of Iman. When you and I say, I put food on my table, it was my deal, it was my idea, it was my effort, I studied hard, I passed my exams. This is dangerous, my dear brothers and sisters. This is I. This is dangerous. This is an element which many of us overlook, which kills the nafs. It hardens it. It takes it away from Allah. You and I must be people who say, as our Shaykh Sa'ad Hafidhahullah, is from the senior scholars of Saudi Arabia right now, he lectures in the Haram in Ramadan. Right? The world flocked to his feet. He says, Hafidhahullah, tie everything to Allah. Everything attributed to Allah. The deal went through, praise be to Allah, who decreed this deal went through. Wallahi, I was nothing but a means, and praise be to Allah who used me as a means. Praise be to Allah who made me study well and made me pass my exams. If it wasn't for the power and might of Allah, I had no chance in passing my exams. Praise be to Allah who gave me the ability to stand and give a public speech. Many times people say, I have self-confidence, I'm a confident person. This is not the speech of a person who's attached to Allah. The speech of a person attached to Allah is, praise be to Allah who gave me the ability to stand in front of people. Wallahi, if it wasn't for Allah and nothing. You understand this, my dear brothers and sisters? We need to train, teach our kids this. Praise be to Allah who found me this pretty wife, who decreed that I have this pretty wife that I have and the qualities that she has. And the female says the same thing about her husband. Not, you know, I'm in demand. You know, some people say, oh no, you know, I have my degrees, I do this, I'm in demand, and all the girls are after me. You know, the female says, no, I'm very pretty, alhamdulillah, the boys line up for me. At least you say, alhamdulillah. Right? No, he says, praise be to Allah, who created me, how he created me, and placed interest in the hearts of people about me. I'm trying to take it to such a minute level that you understand what it means when we say, tie it all to Allah. Praise be to Allah who put food on this table. Not I put food on the table. I go to work to put food on the table. Wallahi, this is not the speech of a person who knows he's Abdullah. He's the servant of Allah. You know, a servant is always provided for. Even in fiqh, the ulama, they discuss, can a slave own anything? Because he is owned himself. So whatever he comes with is owned by his master. You and I are owned, my dear brothers and sisters. What we have is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This eye does not have a place in our life. So rid yourself of the qualities of shaitan. Qualities of shaitan, go and study. What are the qualities of shaitan? And make sure they don't exist in your life. I've highlighted the major quality of shaitan. Being bakhil and stingy. This is from the qualities of shaitan. It's not from the qualities of those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised. Rid yourself of this quality in purifying your nafs. Riya, doing things for people to see. Doing things for gratification from people. That's dangerous. That affects our nafs. You know, wallahi, we could have 1 hour discussions of all these things I'm saying to you right now. All these things. We could have a 1 hour discussion and that would be summarized. Wallahi, I have notes about these things. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There's no power but might except for Allah. This sharia, what Allah revealed to this ummah, wallahi, is great. If we only learned what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam left, we would be great individuals. These are topics that require time. Even if we sat till suhoor, we wouldn't finish. This issue of riya. How many times do we hear people saying, wallahi, I'm not doing it anymore. Why? These people don't appreciate. How many times do we do this? These people don't appreciate. Let them feel my absence. This is dangerous. Why are you doing it for the people to show off? Do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you're doing it for Allah, who cares? If you know my Allah is Ash-Shaheed, my Allah is Ar-Raqib, my Allah is Al-Basir, my Allah is Al-Sami' by Allah, He hears everything and sees everything and witnesses everything and observes everything. How can I worry about what people think and what they don't think? Allah, the creator of everything in creation, the most valuable person for me to have, He's witnessed what I've done. Who needs the thanks of insan who depends on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well? You get what I'm saying, brothers and sisters? We need to rid ourselves of this. This is also one of the evil qualities, tit for tat. Tit for tat attitude. This is the quality of shaitan. If he does, I will do. He visited me, I'll visit him. He gave my child 50 dirhams for Eid, give him 50 dirhams for Eid. Give his child 50 dirhams for Eid. You know, tit for tat attitude. Right? You know, brother, why don't you visit? Well, when did he visit me? That's what we say. Huh? Go ask him, when is he coming to visit me? There's a walima happening. Your friend tells you, are you going for this walima? You say, which walima? So and so. Oh, I didn't know. He didn't invite you. No. He didn't invite me. Tayyib. I mean, he's got one daughter, isn't it? I have three. Don't worry, we'll fix this problem. I have three daughters getting married. We'll see which invite he gets. Right? This is what we do. Tit for tat. This kills the nafs. This is killing the nafs. This is ammaratun bisu. This is when you are a slave of your ego. You are abdul hawa. You are a slave of your desires. You're not abdullah. You're not a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to rid ourselves of tit for tat. Jealousy, my dear brothers and sisters. Jealousy is from the evils as well. It's from the evils that pollutes our nafs and affects our heart. When you and I, we see Allah give a blessing to somebody else, and you and I wish that Allah gives it to us and takes it away from them. This is dangerous. We hate that they have it. This is not ghibta, when you wish Allah gives you and Allah increases for them. But Allah give me as well. That's ghibta, that's good. That's from Iman. That's from Islam. That's from Ihsan. Ghibta, that's different. That's from that the purified self has ghibta. The sick self has hasad. And as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الْحَسَدَ يَأْكُلُ الْحَسَنَاتِ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ النَّارَ الْحَطَبِ. Jealousy eats away your good deeds like fire eats away firewood. Be careful, my dear brothers and sisters. Be careful of your standing on the day of Qiyamah. Wallahi, it's not worth it. Whenever shaitan makes you jealous of someone, think of the good deeds that you're burning. And think how hard it was to get those deeds. You know, like when you're on the treadmill. Huh? When you go on the treadmill, you're looking at the calorie meter. You're running, sweating, tired, exhausted. And it's only 50 calories. And some more, 60 calories, 70 calories. So subhanAllah, I spent 20 minutes, I only burnt 150 calories. And this chocolate here, 200 calories. Say, forget it. I'm not eating this chocolate. Why? I mean, you say, subhanAllah, this, you know, 5 minutes pleasure, half an hour on the treadmill. Doesn't make sense. Right? In the same way, when shaitan is making you jealous, think to yourself, this jealousy is going to eat my good deeds. How hard is it for me to get my good deeds and how easy it is for me to put on weight with sin? Right? But every time shaitan makes you jealous, think of the good deeds that you're burning and you're standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is takhliyah. This is some of takhliyah. Removing the debt. What is from the forms of tahliyah? From the forms of tahliyah and polishing is ikhlas. Living for Allah. Speaking for Allah. Doing for Allah. Acting for Allah. Remaining silent for Allah. Leaving for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is tahliyah. And the best tahliyah is ikhlas. Being sincere. Purifying what you do and making it solely for Allah. It doesn't matter what he says. It doesn't matter who appreciates. It doesn't matter what people think. I am doing it for Allah. The one who created me. The one who says be and things become. The one who is in charge of my fate when I go to him in the hereafter. Then we have what the scholars say, al-inaba. And al-inaba is turning to Allah. Whenever you make a mistake, you turn to Allah. This is from polishing your iman. You see, we make mistakes and sometimes we feel depressed. Subhanallah, I asked Allah for I went for hajj, I came back, I made a mistake, I made a sin. What happens? Now, you start slowly but surely becoming more sinful. No. Never be regret the mistake because of your iman in Allah. But don't let that be an avenue for shaitan to take you further away. What should you do? Something known as al-inaba. Turn back to Allah. Allah loves you turning back to Him. I made a mistake, I turned back to Allah. This is from strengthening your iman. Then we have khawf and we discussed it, which is fear of Allah. And we have khashya and we discussed it, which is fear with knowledge. And then we have tawadu, which is being humble. This is the opposite of arrogance. The opposite of what you see in the field of what requires cleaning is what you find in the field of what entails polishing. The opposite of arrogance is humbleness. Remove arrogance and polish yourself with humbleness. You see? Tawadu. At-tawadu. At-tawadu. Also, brothers and sisters, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is from polishing. To thank Allah. I have a talk online, just the audio, the videos with the conference in Malaysia. And it's the hadith where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Aisha radiallahu anha, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. I don't know the title of the talk, what it was called. But it's to do with thanks. When he stood the night, and his feet are swelling, and his beloved wife peeps from the blankets to see what's happening. And she says, why? Allah has forgiven you. And he says, should I not be a thankful slave? thankful for Allah choosing me to, Allahu Akbar, choosing me for the most noblest of tasks and prophethood. Should I not be a thankful slave? Thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala happens through you thanking Allah with your tongue. And thanking Allah happens with you trying to stay away from sin. And thanking Allah happens in action as well, which is salah and zakah and sadaqah and fasting. And thanking Allah happens by your heart as well, by growing the qualities of the heart, the iman and the taqwa, the qualities of the heart, the khawf and the khashya. There's many qualities of the heart, brothers and sisters. So we thank Allah with our tongue, and we thank Allah with our bodies, and we thank Allah with our hearts. This is from the greatest way of purifying the self. Right? Alhamdulillah, you know, even though we're running through because time is against us, and as I said, these are topics in and of itself, Allah has blessed this ummah with many talks dealing with these topics, and they're available online. You just need to take the effort to find one, decent one, and listen to it. Understand what is shukr. Understand what is khashya. Understand what is khawf. Understand what is taqwa. What is iman. And if you have time, I advise you to register for just a 4-month course online with Knowledge International University. Title: Purification of the Soul. You will get notes in the English language, translated notes from some of Ibn al-Qayyim's works, Madarij al-Salikin, and you will have lectures by Sheikh Sa'ad al-Shithri, Hafidhahullah, recorded sessions with the translations, and I teach the live sessions for this particular program. And this is a course which we offer to non-students. They can pay for it and study it themselves. 1 semester program, around 4 months, 3 to 4 months, depending on the academic calendar here in the Middle East. I advise you to do it, brothers and sisters. I advise you to do it. I see some young people in the audience. I'm going to end just with some advice to our youngsters here. And I'm sure your parents tell you as well. Because you are our today and tomorrow. The scholars teach us about purification of the soul. And they tell us from the best ways of purifying the soul is not to speak too much, not to eat too much, and not to have bad friends, and not to have evil glances. Why I'm saying it to the young people, because uncle's glances now are khalas, inshallah. And uncles are staying away from all these foods, sugar, this, that, you know, high blood pressure, cholesterol, we're not eating too much anyway. May Allah give us all shifa. Ameen. And protect us. Ameen. 4 things to my young brothers and sisters. Don't speak too much. Speaking too much hardens the heart. Don't eat too much. Eating too much hardens the heart. You know, when you bloated and you can't breathe, and eating and restaurants and unhealthy food and all, your whole day is about where we're eating next. Right? Don't. Eating is a means of survival. We eat to live. We don't live to eat. Have you heard that line? We eat to live. We don't live to eat. Don't eat too much. Don't have bad company, bad friends. Bad friends will destroy your nafs and destroy your heart. Friends who don't remind you about Allah and His Rasul and the hereafter, they are dangerous friends. Don't spend time with them. I'm not saying they are bad and you should judge them as bad, but I'm saying for your own development, stay away from them. Remember, the topic is tazkiyah, and tazkiyah refers to development as well of the nafs. Stay away from them. And you know the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the good friend and the bad friend. The good friend is like the one who sells perfume, and the bad friend is like the one who smells iron. He works near the blast furnace. You heard about this? When you go visit the perfume selling friend, it's either he's so generous, he'll give you a whole bottle of itr. So you benefited, mashallah, whole bottle of itr. And if he's not so generous, then he will take out a bottle from under the counter and tell you to try some. Right? You tried some itr. So did you benefit? Yes, you benefited. And if he's even not that generous, then at least you being in his shop with all these nice scents It will rub onto your clothes. When you leave that shop, did you benefit?
Yes.
You benefited. Good friend company always benefits you. Always. But bad friend company is like the friend who smells iron. Look at the wisdom of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaching us so simply. He says, when you visit the friend who works at the blast furnace, if you get too close to the blast furnace, the spark will come out and burn your clothes.
That's where the action is.
That's what the action is. When you're in the mixer. And if you say, you know what, I am going to be careful. Like my parents told me these people are not good friends, should stay away from them. Okay, no problem. I still will be their friends, but I'll be careful. And you say, I'll stand far away from the blast furnace. Then the black smoke in the room will blacken your clothes. And if you say, oh, no, I want to be super careful. I want to stand right at the door. 1 foot out the door, 1 foot in the door. Then the carbon monoxides of that environment you have to breathe. So when you leave that environment,
gas mask.
Do you win or lose? Gas mask, mashallah. Mashallah, see, this is the youth today. Wallahi, this is the young people today. You know, a long time ago, when I had an IT business, in the afternoon I would go and volunteer at the madrasa. And there was this little kid. So one kid was, I was talking to somebody and I said, you mustn't cry over spilled milk. So the little kid said, why? I said, because it's spilled, it's khalas. Go get more milk. He goes, no. We can drink that milk. I said, it's dirty. How are you going to drink it? He says, no, there's vacuums. Can suck up the milk and be very clean, and you can pour it into a glass and you can drink it. So I said, mashallah, you know, I'm not that old, you know, but subhanallah, when I hear these things, so you can wear gas mask. Okay, so you wear gas mask, but don't you have to take out the gas mask sometimes? And how ugly do you look with a gas mask on? It's not fashionable, right? See, you clever, we clever. No, mashallah. So don't have bad friend company. And don't have unrestrained glances. When I say unrestrained glances, I mean two things. Number one, don't look at the girls. Lower your gaze. Even for the sisters, don't look at the boys. Lower your gaze. The moment you have an unrestricted glance, know by default you have polluted your nafs and your heart. You have opened a big door for shaitan. Number one. Number two, when I say don't have unrestricted glances, don't look at the bling of this dunya. These Lamborghinis and all these amazing things. You know, kids, we're all into all these fast cars and Lamborghini and the latest mobile phone and all this. Don't look at these things without remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't say, wow, look at that car. Say, how amazing is my Allah who inspired insan to create that car. That is better for you to say. Do you get what I'm saying? You see what I'm saying? That will grow your nafs. It won't burn your nafs. That will build your nafs. It won't burn your nafs. Is that clear, brothers and sisters? Right? There's many more things we can say, but in my experience with the young people, I've gathered these four advices. Don't speak too much. Don't eat too much, don't have bad friends, and don't have unrestricted glances. Don't. And maybe number five, never do anything in excess. As a general rule. Ibn al-Qayyim says, إِذَا زَادَ الشَّيْءَ حَدِّهِ إِنْقَلَبَ عَلَى ضِدِّهِ. Anything which is done more than required becomes negative, becomes harmful. You sleep, sleeping is good? Yes, but too much sleep? It's bad. Studying is good? Yes. But too much study is bad. Playing Xbox is good?
No.
Depends what we're playing, isn't it? But playing too much is bad. They say all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. But all play and no work makes Jack a duller boy. All right? It makes him a duller boy. So anything in excess, sports, too much sports is bad for you. Have a balance in your life. Allah asked us to do 5 times salah in a day. Compulsory. Not more, not less. He asked us to fast 1 month of the year. Not more, not less. One hajj a lifetime. Not more, not less. Imam al-Shatibi, rahmatullahi alayhi, in his al-Muwafaqat says, Allah asked us for 5, not 6, because 6 would have retrogressive results. We'll start hating the ibadah. 2 hajjs compulsory, retrogressive. 1 hajj builds us. 2 or more, as compulsory. Some people, Allah has given them the ability to go themselves more. That's different. But remember, the sharia is for everybody. What you do extra, فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ, is good for you. But the minimum is 1. You understand? Don't do anything in excess. Remember this, my young brothers and sisters. Barakallahu feekum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the sitting from us. And I ask you from the bottom of my heart not to let these words go astray. Everything correct said is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's perfect, and any mistakes are from myself and shaitan, and I seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness. May Allah accept our Ramadan, and accept our fasting, and accept our standing. May Allah decree upon us all to witness Laylatul Qadr. May He inspire us to be the best that we can be on that night, and achieve the great reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed for those who witness that night. May Allah decree us to be from amongst those that have been freed from the hellfire during this month. May Allah make us people of taqwa at the end of this month. May Allah make us people that are His greatest worshippers after this month, and not people who only worship Allah in Ramadan. May Allah protect our hearts and protect our iman and protect our Islam. Protect us from shaitan and protect us from the evil of ourselves and the adverse consequences of our deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cause us to die whilst He's pleased with us. Ameen. May Allah send us angels from Jannah the day we breathe our last. Ameen. May Allah grant us a grave which is a garden from the gardens of Jannah. Ameen. And may Allah grant us shade underneath His arsh on the day of Qiyamah. Ameen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease our standing in front of Him. And grant us our book of deeds in our right hands. Ameen. And decree that we be from amongst the people of Al-Firdaws Al-A'la. So we can sit with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell him of one fine night during one fine Ramadan that we sat together in the city of Dubai, learning from the inheritance that he left behind before he passed away sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.